Hello everyone, hope you all are doing well, taking care of yourself as well as your family. In this video lecture, we are going to discuss about the Pelton wheel turbine. The discussion includes main components of Pelton wheel turbine, drawing velocity triangles at inlet and at outlet, and deriving the equation for the work done per second by the jet of water on the Pelton wheel buckets, and various efficiencies. So let's start from the main component of Pelton wheel turbine. The first component is the penstock. Penstock is used to take the water from reservoir to the inlet of the turbine. At the end of the penstock, there would be a nozzle provided. Nozzle at the tapered pipe section, where the area of pipe section would get reduced. The function of this nozzle is to convert whatever the pressure or energy available in the penstock into a useful kinetic energy. So whenever water is flowing through this nozzle, it will be get accelerated, and with that accelerated flow, with that huge amount of kinetic energy, jet of water is going to strike on the blade. Whatever the water is coming out from the nozzle, that will come in the form of jet of water, and with that higher kinetic energy, that jet of water is going to strike on the bucket, and those bucket would get displaced. The next component is the spear, or it is also called as a needle. So its function is to control the flow which is coming out from the nozzle. That is nothing but controlling the discharge. So if I am moving this needle in the forward direction, at that time area of flow would get reduced, and discharge coming out from the nozzle would also get reduced. If I am moving this jet in the backward direction, at that time area of flow would get restored, and again discharge which is coming out from the nozzle would also get restored. The next component is the casing. So whenever my jet of water going to strike on the blade, some splashes of water coming out due to that striking, and those splashes will be prevented by the casing and safely discharged to the tail race. So this is only the function of casing. The casing is not going to serve any hydraulic function in case of Pelton wheel turbine, because Pelton wheel turbine is totally working under the kinetic energy, and whatever the pressure available at the inlet and at the outlet of Pelton wheel turbine is atmospheric pressure. So casing is only going to prevent those splashes which is coming out after striking, or also going to work as a safeguard against the any accident. The next one is, next component is the runner, over which all the buckets and vanes are mounted. So runner is the circular disc on which all the buckets are mounted with the even space in each apart. So on this runner, my all buckets are mounted, and this runner is coupled with the shaft at the center. So whenever my jet of water striking on those buckets, buckets would get displaced. As those buckets are mounted on the circular wheel, also called as runner, those is going to produce the rotational energy. As this rotational energy will be taken by this shaft, and that rotational energy will be transmitted to the electrical generator, where it will be further converted into the electrical energy. So bucket, which is most important part of the Pelton wheel turbine, if you see here, those are the my bucket which are bolted on the runner circular wheel, and which is coupled with the shaft. So all the buckets which are evenly spaced and mounted on the bucket, if you look at the picture of this, typical picture of this single bucket, so if you see here, the shape of bucket is double hemispherical, and which is divided symmetrically into two parts by providing the ridge line at the center, and this ridge line is known as splitter. So my jet of water is going to strike on that splitter, at the center of that splitter, and get divided into two halves after striking. Again, if you see in the bucket, whatever the at the outer rim of the bucket, one small notch is provided. So that notch is going to ensure that there will be a no blockage of jet of water, path of jet of water when it is striking to the preceding bucket. So let's understand that by considering one bucket. So let us consider this bucket on which my jet of water is striking. So I am considering this bucket on which my jet of water is striking straight horizontally. Now when it is striking, this bucket will move and next bucket will come on its position. Now whenever this bucket coming to that position, at that time the path of jet would get disturbed by this back side of that bucket, and by providing this notch, that obstruction will be get prevented. So this notch will ensure that there will be no obstruction in the path of jet of water when jet is striking to the preceding bucket. Now, whenever my jet of water coming out from the nozzle, going to strike on the splitter of the bucket. So if I draw the sectional line, so if I draw take the section of bucket from this portion, so it would be look like this. Now my jet of water coming horizontally going to strike at the splitter of the bucket, and after striking at the splitter, it will be get divided into two halves, and that both the halves going to follow the contour of bucket and going to get deflected at the outlet point. So if I am considering my jet of water striking at this point, first point, that would be my inlet point, and that point from where my jet of water is coming out, that would be my outlet point. So whatever the angle of this bucket at the inlet is also known as inlet tip angle, and whatever the angle made by bucket at this outlet point, that is known as outlet tip angle. So that angle, both the angle generally measured with respect to the direction of motion. So my direction of jet as well as bucket is going to move in the rightward direction. So both the angle at inlet as well as at outlet will be measured with respect to the direction of motion. So my jet of water coming and striking at the splitter and getting divided into two halves and gliding over the contour of the bucket or inner face of the bucket and going to leave the bucket at the point 2, at the outlet point. Now if I am going to see here, whatever my inlet point in this bucket would be this one, and outlet point would be this one. So if I am going to consider any of the bucket, so my if I am considering this bucket, so my inlet point would be this one and outlet point would be this one. So if I am measuring the radial distance of those two points from the center, so radial distance of those two points would be the similar. So if I am considering the tangential velocity at those two points of the wheel would be the same. So remember this concept, because while drawing the Pelton wheel velocity vector diagram for the Pelton wheel turbine, this is very important. So let's proceed to draw the velocity vector diagram at inlet and as well as at outlet. So let us consider V1 and V2. So here suffix 1 is referring the inlet point and suffix 2 is referring the outlet point. So V1 and V2 are the absolute velocities of the jet at inlet and at outlet respectively. U1, U2 are the respected peripheral velocity of the vane, or also called as tangential velocity. VR1 and VR2 are the respected relative velocities at inlet and at outlet. VF1 and VF2 are the respected velocity of flow. VW1, VW2 are the respected velocity of whirl. Theta and phi are the tip angles at inlet and at outlet respectively, where those theta and phi also known as angle made by resultant velocity VR1 at the inlet and VR2 at the outlet. And the last one is the alpha and beta, which is angle made by the absolute velocity or also angle made by the jet of water with respect to the direction of motion at the inlet and at outlet. So this would be my inlet, this would be my velocity triangle at inlet as well as outlet. Starting from the inlet point, my jet of water coming in the form of straight horizontal line and going to strike at the splitter, and after that it will be divided into two halves. So in the both the outlet tips, so this at this outlet tip and at this outlet tip, my velocity triangle would be the same. So we will consider only one outlet velocity triangle. So at the inlet velocity triangle, my velocity vector diagram would be the straight horizontal line, because my jet of water coming straight horizontally and going to strike at the splitter. So due to that straight horizontal line, my alpha would get reduced to zero, theta will also zero. And again, if my velocity V1 is not making an angle with respect to the direction of motion, my VF1 will also become zero, and then there will be only a horizontal component of velocity V1, that is VW1. Next, U1 and U2 are the peripheral velocity at inlet and at outlet. As we have discussed, both are located at same radial distance from the center. So my U1 will be equal to U2, it will be equal to U. Those are the tangential velocity or peripheral velocity of the vane. So once I show that V1 here at this point, after that I can easily calculate my relative velocity, which will be given by the velocity of the jet minus velocity of the bucket. That is nothing but V1 minus U1, or horizontal component of V1, VW1 minus U1 will be equal to VR1. After striking at the splitter, my jet of water coming out at the nozzle, the first component coming out, that is VR2, that is relative velocity of the jet at the outlet. Now if I am considering my bucket is smooth, and in that case all the frictional losses can be ignored, and if I am not considering the frictional losses, whatever my relative velocity at the inlet would be remain same at the outlet. So first component coming out, that is VR2, that would be equal to VR1 if we are ignoring the frictional losses. Now VR2 making an angle phi with respect to the direction of motion, where phi is the outlet tip angle, which is generally varies in between 10 to 15 degree. Now whenever my jet of water striking at the splitter and coming out at the nozzle, it is getting deflected from its original direction. So my previous direction was of the jet was like this, that is direction of motion, but after that it is getting deflected back. So whatever this angle by which it is getting deflected, that is known as angle of deflection, and which is generally calculated as 180 minus outlet tip angle, or 180 minus phi. So VR2 is making angle phi with respect to direction of motion. Next component coming out at the outlet point, that is V2, absolute velocity of the jet at the outlet. So whenever my absolute velocity of jet coming at the outlet, it is coming which is making an angle beta with respect to the direction of motion. As my V2 making an angle a beta with respect to the direction of motion, it will be get divided into two component, horizontal and vertical. Whatever my vertical component is known as velocity of flow, and horizontal component is known as velocity of whirl. As those both the velocities, both the components are located at the outlet, those are will be denoted as VF2 and VW2, where suffix 2 is referring the position of that value at the outlet point. Now here we have considered my beta, which is less than 90 degree. That's why my resolving component of VW2 showing this direction, but there may be a possibility that this beta may be greater than 90 degree. In that case, it would be look like it would be that beta would be like this in this direction. So in that condition, my vertical component would be the same, but horizontal direction of VW2 would be the rightward direction, that is nothing but in the direction of motion. So that would be the different case. Again, there may be a possibility that my V2 is coming out in the radial direction, that is nothing but beta is equal to 90 degrees. So we are going to consider all those conditions. So this is nothing but the velocity diagram at the outlet for the first condition, where my beta is less than 90 degree. So this may be the condition when my Pelton wheel turbine is the low speed turbine. Again, for the medium speed turbine, this beta would be equal to 90 degree. So whenever my beta is equal to 90 degree, at that time my V2 will become equal to VF2, and in that case my VW2 will become 0. So in that case, this horizontal component will totally equal to the U2, and inlet velocity triangle would be the same, all the other components would be the same. In the next, when my Pelton wheel turbine is the high speed turbine, in that case my beta would be the greater than 90 degree. So whenever my beta is greater than 90 degree, at that time its resolving component VW2 will will be the in direction of motion, that is shown here, VW2. Now in that case, my U2 will become this one, this whole length from this point to this point, and VW2 will showing the will having the direction of in the direction of motion. All other components will be the same. Those are the three conditions. Remember those three conditions, because whatever the force exerted by the jet of water on the buckets of Pelton wheel turbine will totally depend on the angle beta. Let's move to the next. Let's start to compute the force exerted by the jet of water on the bucket. Before proceeding, let us consider the inlet velocity triangle, what we can get from the inlet velocity triangle. So if I look at the inlet velocity triangle, my jet of water coming straight without making an angle with respect to the direction of motion. So whatever my inlet velocity triangle would be the straight line only. Also alpha and theta would become 0, and my u1 and u2 both are equal to u, and which can be get calculated by using pi dn upon 60, where d is the diameter of wheel and n is the speed in revolution per minute. Which can be calculated as 60 f divided by p, where f is the frequency in hertz and p is the power. Now from the inlet velocity triangle, we can say that v1 will be equal to the vw1 and my vf1 will be equal to the 0. Also vr1 can be get calculated by using velocity of jet in direction of motion minus velocity of wheel, that is vw1 minus u1. As VW1 is also equal to V1, so I can say that my VR1 will be equal to V1 minus U. Let's move to the outlet velocity triangle. So here we are considering the first condition when my beta is less than 90 degree, that is acute angle. In that case, my outlet velocity triangle would be like this. As I am considering my vane or blade of the Pelton wheel turbine is smooth, so my frictional losses would be the zero as I am considering it. In that case, my relative velocity at the inlet will be equal to relative velocity at the outlet. Now, from by looking to this angle phi at the outlet, I can say that cos of phi will be equal to this adjacent u2 plus vw2 divided by vr2. So, I can compute here vw2, that would be equal to vr2 cos of phi minus u. Now, let's move to compute the force exerted by the jet of water on the bucket. In the case of when beta is less than 90 degree, when beta is acute angle, so we know that force exerted by the jet of water in the direction of motion on the buckets is given by the momentum principle, that is given by rate of change of momentum in that same direction in which we are calculating the force. So we know that in the previous video lecture we have discussed this rate of change of momentum in the same direction. So that is given by mass of fluid flowing per second multiplied by initial velocity minus final velocity. Now, if we see initial velocity of the jet in direction of motion was the horizontal component of initial velocity, it was Vw1. And now if we see final velocity of a jet of water, that is after striking, that would be equal to Vw2. Now, if you see here my velocity of component of velocity of jet after striking, showing the direction opposite to the direction of motion, that is nothing but in the leftward direction, but my actual direction of motion is this one. So in this condition we need to take the negative sign. So here it is, final velocity of jet is minus Vw2, sorry, here it is Vw2. So please consider this, it is Vw2, negative sign indicating that final velocity is in opposite direction of motion. Now, force exerted by jet of water will be given by the mass of fluid flowing per second multiplied by initial velocity minus final velocity. Now, we know that mass of fluid flowing per second is given by density multiplied by Q, where for the Q, I can write down A multiplied by V1, where A is the area of jet of water or area of nozzle, and V1 is the velocity of jet multiplied by Vw1 minus Vw2. So minus minus would get plus. So my f of x, that is force exerted by jet of water on the bucket, should be given by rho a V1 multiplied by Vw1 plus Vw2, where a is area of jet, that can be calculated as pi by 4 d square, where d is the diameter of the jet or diameter of the nozzle. Now I can easily compute the work done by jet on the runner per second, that is equal to force multiplied by velocity, where force is nothing but force which is acting in that same direction in which direction my object is moving. So here my object is the vane, so I am going to consider force exerted by jet of water on the vane multiplied by velocity of that vane which is moving. So that would be given by rho a v1 multiplied by vw1 plus vw2 multiplied by u, where u is nothing but the object velocity of the vane. And this work done per second is the equation of power. So I can calculate, I can say here my power is equal to rho a v1 multiplied by vw1 plus vw2 multiplied by u. So unit of this equation is newton meter per second, or we can write it as watts. Now in the next condition, when my beta is greater than 90 degree, in that condition my direction of vw2 would be the rightward direction, that would be nothing but say in the same direction of motion. So in that case my equation of f of x would be slightly get modified, and here there will be a minus sign. So again my work done per second will also get equation for work done per second will also get modified slightly. It will be Vw1 minus Vw2. So in general I can write down for the work done by the jet on the runner per second equal to rho a v1 Vw1 plus minus Vw2 multiplied by u, where this plus sign will be there when my beta is less than 90 degree, and this minus sign would be taken when my beta is greater than 90 degree. And in the third case, when my beta is equal to 90 degree, in that case just in the previous equation just put the value of Vw2 is equal to 0, you will get the required equation for work done per second. So here it is my work done per second equation, that would be the same to the previous equation, just the difference is that at the outlet point there would be no Vw2 component. So just put the value of Vw2 in the previous equation, you will get the value equation for the work done per second by the jet of water on the plates, that is given by rho a v1 multiplied by Vw1 multiplied by u. Let's move to the efficiencies. There are various efficiencies which are generally involved while calculating the various performance related parameters of the Pelton wheel turbine. So there are some efficiency that we are going to discuss. Just look at this picture. So whenever we are considering the dam, so at the reservoir we are going to store the potential energy of water that would be stored in the form of particular head of the water, that is H. But whenever we are taking this water from the reservoir to the turbine, at that time the same head will not available at the inlet of turbine, because whenever water is flowing through those penstock, it will be subjected to some frictional losses. So whatever the net head available at the inlet of turbine, that would be the slightly less than whatever head available at the reservoir due to the reduction of head loss due to friction. So if I am considering this as output energy and this as input energy, so if I divide the head available at the inlet of turbine divided by head available at the reservoir, that is going to give us the transmission efficiency. Now next, whatever the head available or energy available at the inlet of the turbine, that is here, that will be not totally converted into the runner power. Whatever the runner power is nothing but the same will not going to convert it into the rotational energy. So that is my runner power. So this total energy available at the inlet turbine will not get converted totally into the runner power or into the rotational energy. So if I am going to consider this as output power, that is runner power, that we can calculate the equation, which is just we have derived work done equation, work done per second. And if we divide it with the power, water power energy, we know that equation for the water power energy is given by rho gqh. So if we divide this as output energy divided by input energy, that efficiency is known as hydraulic efficiency. Now next, whatever the power available at the runner of the turbine would not be the same at the shaft of the turbine which we are going to transmit to the generator. In this section in the shaft, there are some mechanical losses, and due to those mechanical losses there are some energy loss. So if I am going to take power available at the shaft divided by power available at the runner, that is known as mechanical efficiency. Now those two efficiencies are important in case of Pelton wheel turbine. So if I take the product of those two efficiency, hydraulic efficiency multiplied by mechanical efficiency, that is going to give me the overall efficiency of the Pelton wheel turbine. Again at the end, if I am going to take electrical power which is generated by the generator and power supplied by the shaft to the generator, so if I take this output power divided by input power, I will get the generator efficiency, among which we are going to discuss those three efficiencies in detail. So first one is the hydraulic efficiency. It is a ratio of runner power to the power available at the inlet of turbine, that is water power. So whatever hydraulic efficiency is given by work done per second divided by kinetic energy per second, which is supplied by the water, or runner power divided by water power. Now we know that equation for the work done per second, which is given by rho a v1 multiplied by vw1 plus vw2 multiplied by u, and kinetic energy, that is given by half mv square. Just put the value half mv square per second. We have in previous lecture we have derived the equation for this kinetic energy per second, which is given by rho a v1 multiplied by v1 square. So if you just put the value, those values in this equation, you will get the equation for the efficiency. It would be this one. Again, if I are going to consider the force exerted by the jet of water, so you can also write down the equation for hydraulic efficiency. That will be given by, if you take the water power equation as rho gqh, in spite of this taking this rho a v1 multiplied by v1 square, if we take the value of water power as rho gqh, in that case equation for the hydraulic efficiency will be vw1 plus vw2 multiplied by u divided by gh. And if I am going to consider this equation, in that case my hydraulic efficiency equation would be like this. Both are the same expression, just remember this, or you can simply remember its equation, work done per second, and divide it with rho gqh, you will get the efficiency. Next one is the mechanical efficiency. It is the ratio of shaft power to the power available at the runner, that is nothing but shaft power divided by the runner power. So we know that runner power, we already calculated, shaft power is nothing but output which we are getting at the shaft power. So expression for the mechanical efficiency would be this: shaft power divided by work done per second by the Pelton wheel of by the jet of water on the buckets of Pelton wheel. And the next one is the overall efficiency. So it is the ratio of ultimate power getting out as output from the Pelton wheel turbine, that is nothing but we are getting mechanical energy from the turbines. So mechanical energy will be our ultimate output power, and input power will be nothing but the water power. So if I take the ratio of shaft power, that is mechanical power divided by water power, I am going to get the overall efficiency. Just multiply this expression, shaft power divided by water power, multiply and divide with the runner power, divide and multiply it with the runner power. Now I can simplify it. Just write down this shaft power divided by runner power and runner power divided by water power. So this shaft power divided by runner power is the mechanical efficiency, and this runner power divided by water power is the hydraulic efficiency. So the product of hydraulic efficiency and mechanical efficiency is the overall efficiency. The next one is the volumetric efficiency. Now whatever the volume of water coming to the turbine, it doesn't mean that same volume of water going to strike on the turbine. So both will be the different, whatever the water supplied by the penstock and whatever the water striking, actually striking through the turbine, both would be the difference. So if I take the ratio of volume of water which is actually striking to the runner divided by volume of water supplied by the jet at the inlet of turbine, so that ratio is going to give us the volumetric efficiency. We are in most of the cases the value of the volumetric efficiency is very less, and generally it is avoided and assumed as equal to 1. So let's sum up what we have discussed in this lecture. So the first one, work done per second, equation for the work done per second, rho a v1 multiplied by vw1 plus minus vw2 multiplied by u. This is nothing but the plus sign whenever my beta is less than 90 degree, negative sign when my beta is greater than 90 degree, and if my beta is equal to 90 degree, just put the value of vw2 is equal to 0 in this equation. The next one is hydraulic efficiency, which can be calculated by using equation vw1 plus minus vw2 multiplied by u divided by gh, or can also be get calculated to in bracket vw1 plus minus vw2 multiplied by u divided by v1 square. The next one, overall efficiency, which is given by shaft power p divided by water power rho g qh. And now remember some typical points which are generally used in this. In the next lecture we are going to solve the numericals on the Pelton wheel turbine. So in that case you just remember some thumb rules. So if only in the numerical, if it is mentioned only the efficiency without mentioning mechanical, overall or hydraulic efficiency, just treat that efficiency as hydraulic efficiency. Next one, if Q is not given in the numerical, then calculate Q by using overall efficiency. If U is not given, then calculate U by using this equation Ku under root 2 twice of GH, where K is the speed ratio, and then calculate D by using this relationship. And the last one, once calculated number of jet and rounded to the next full integer, then recalculate diameter of jet for the modified discharge. Just remember those thumb rules. If you don't understand it, keep it in mind while solving the numerical. We will discuss it again. So in this lecture, that's it. In the next lecture, we will solve some numerical on the Pelton wheel turbine. Thank you.